All right. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. My name is Maura Boudreau. I work for the Library and Programs on Publicity. And we're here today to talk with dietitian Emily from Stop and Chat about cooking with fall favorites. She's in our kitchen right now. Oops, excuse me, that was my email. A couple of things before we get started. This meeting is being recorded. So if you want to watch it after the program, you can certainly do that. I'll probably have it edited by tomorrow for everyone. If you do have any questions, what you can do is put them in the chat box to the lower right-hand corner, and we'll be able to ask Emily at the end of the program. Let me give an introduction to Emily, and then I will turn it over to her. Emily is a registered dietitian for the Nutrition Partners program at Stop and Shop. Emily's love for all things food, along with a fascination for nutrition science, sparked her passion for becoming a registered dietitian. She believes that all foods fit and enjoys helping individuals build balanced eating patterns that will support them in reaching their personal health and wellness goals. And with that, I will turn it over to Emily.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Maura, for that introduction there. And yes, hello, everyone. My name is Emily. As Maura said, I am a registered dietitian for Stop and Shop on our Nutrition Partners program. Now, for those of you that haven't heard of us before, I'm happy just to give a brief overview here of our program. So Nutrition Partners is the team of dietitians at Stop and Shop, and we offer a variety of complementary nutrition services for our customers, our community members, and our associates as well. So all throughout the month, you can find our dietitians hosting nutrition classes on a variety of different nutrition topics that anyone can sign up for that lives in our regions. We're also available for one-on-one consultations, and we have a wide library of educational resources available on our website. So everything from short nutrition and cooking videos to downloadable handouts. We have some fun blog posts as well, and some better for you products and recipes. So really a lot of great content there on the website. And so if you are just interested to learn more about us, feel free to head over to that site, and that's stopandshop.com/nutrition. So you can find out more about us there. But I am really happy to be doing this program here tonight with all of you on fall favorites. So as the name of the workshop implied, we are going to be cooking with a few of my favorite of fall favorites. So to jump right in here to the cooking demo, I'll first talk about the two different seasonal produce items that we will be highlighting. And we're going to be highlighting winter squash. So especially as we're coming into these cold weather fall and soon winter months, winter squash really comes into season. And if you've ever taken a trip down your produce aisle during the fall and winter months, you've likely seen a pretty big display with different winter squash options. And there really are so many different types. You'll see different colors and shapes and sizes, and they all have different tastes and different uses. So I wanted to pull out and highlight two of my favorite ones to give you all a little bit of inspiration for how you can pick those up at the store and how to put them into use to some tasty and delicious recipes. So without further ado, the two squash I'm going to be highlighting tonight is butternut squash. So this is going to be one of the ones we're talking about, as well as spaghetti squash. Now, this certainly is not an all-encompassing list because there are so many different squashes out there, but these tend to be some more of the options that maybe more folks are familiar with. So maybe could be a good option to start out with. So we're first going to talk all about the butternut squash, and I'll share a recipe for that, and then we'll move into the spaghetti squash. So starting with our butternut squash, I guess I should first start off by saying that these are seasonal produce items, as I mentioned, and whenever possible, I always love to call out that it can be great to eat seasonally. Now, a few different reasons why. First off, since when items are in season, they're abundantly growing because they're available at that time of the year. So you might find that those picks are a little bit more of an affordable option. Maybe they'll help save you a little bit more money compared to items that are not in season. Those items might be a little bit more expensive when it's out of season. So shopping seasonally, can help us all stick to a budget. And not to mention, by shopping seasonally, you're naturally going to get some variety in your diet, because the items that are in season throughout the year are going to change. So if we're eating through the seasons, we're naturally going to get that variety in our diet, which is going to help really build that balanced and nutrient-rich eating pattern. So really a lot of great fun ways of why it's helpful to eat seasonally. So jumping back to my butternut squash, let's talk about how you could get this seasonal item into some meals you're cooking. So the first thing I guess I should mention is, how do you know what butternut squash to pick up at the store? So something you'll want to look for when it comes to butternut squash, but also spaghetti squash and really all winter squash in general, is to pick an option that has no cuts or cracks, because that likely means we have a less optimal product than something that has no cuts or you know, cracks or blemishes. Feeling for an item too that feels heavy for its weight. So you want the squash to have a little bit of weight to it. That means the inside, the flesh, is going to be delicious and ripe and ready to enjoy. So those would be two things to look out for when it comes to choosing your squash at the store. And then when you get home and it's time to store the squash, winter squashes do best in a cool, dry place, or on your countertop would also work fine as well. Now, butternut squash, to highlight some nutrition benefits here, is an excellent source of vitamin A. Now, vitamin A, maybe some of us know or some of us think of vision health, and that certainly is the case. So vitamin A helps support normal or healthy vision. But vitamin A actually plays an important role in our immune system. So it helps support the immune system. And vitamin C tends to get the spotlight on itself during the cold weather months as that immune supporting nutrient, but there are a variety of nutrients that play in there. Like I said, especially vitamin A. So getting in some butternut squash can also help in that way as well. So a lot of great reasons to pick up a butternut squash. So let's talk about ways that we could put it to use. Now, some easy ways could be just chopping it up and roasting it in the oven. You could also make a really delicious butternut squash soup. So roast up some of the butternut squash, puree it, and then have a really tasty soup there. But the way that we are going to put this to use tonight is a little bit more unique. So hopefully it's a different recipe for all of you joining at home. And that's butternut squash fries. Now, I wanted to highlight this recipe, especially for any of you folks at home joining in that might have kids at home. Because something I get asked often as a dietitian is, my kid is a picky eater. How do I get them to try new veggies? Or my kids won't eat any fruits or veggies. Help, what can I do? And so one tip that I have when thinking about ways to get kids or even maybe adults to try new vegetables is to present them in approachable and comfortable ways. So a French fry is the way that we're going to, you know, present our butternut squash tonight, because French fries generally are, you know, a comfortable and delicious food that most folks like. And so presenting the squash in that way might make kids a little bit more inclined to even take a few bites out of the butternut squash fries. And do know that it can take repeated exposure to get kids to try a new vegetable and start to develop a taste for it. So even 1, 2, 3 tries might be enough. It really might be that multiple or repetitive exposure. So don't get discouraged if you have some picky kids at home and maybe this recipe could be something fun to try out. And it is also delicious for adults as well. I should put that caveat in there. It's not just for kids. Anyone can enjoy this. So let's walk through the steps of how to make these butternut squash fries. And you'll see they're quite simple. So what you'll want to do, take your butternut squash and cut it in half, which, surprise, I actually did already ahead of time. So I have my cut butternut squash. And what you want to do with really any winter squash is when you open it up is to find the portion here that has the stringy innards and the seeds. And we want to remove that since we don't quite want that for our fries recipe. So all you want to do is grab a spoon and then just go ahead and take out those innards and those seeds there. Now, if you like to get creative in the kitchen, one way that you could actually use that creativity and cut back on food waste would be to repurpose the seeds here that are inside of the squash. So the butternut squash seeds just like a pumpkin seed could be something that you take out, drizzle with some oil, add some spices, and then roast in the oven, and you could enjoy them as is. For tonight, I will just be discarding this, but just wanted to call that out there. All right, so I removed my innards there. And the next thing that we want to do is I'm going to peel the outer skin. So I'm not going to want the outer skin for the French fries. I really just want the flesh. So I'm just going to take a plain old potato peeler here and just peel down the sides as you would a potato or if you were peeling an apple. So I'll go ahead and peel off some of those, that outer layer there. And you'll want to peel until you start to see that nice, vibrant orange coming through. Not sure if it's showing up too well in camera, but once you start to see that orange compared to the flesh color, you know that's, you can move on to the next section. So I'll go ahead and peel that off. And I will call out, technically, butternut squash, the skin here, it is edible, you know, food safety reasons, or wouldn't necessarily be a reason why you couldn't eat it. But our winter squashes tend to have a more, tougher skin, a tougher exterior than like a summer squash. So with zucchini or a yellow summer squash, you likely just eat that without peeling the outside because that skin is so delicate. But for these winter squashes, I do generally recommend peeling and or, removing before enjoying. All right, so I've done a good job of taking all that skin off here. So you can see that nice orange color really coming through. And the next thing that I want to do is cut the squash into fry-like sticks. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut it in half here so I have a nice French fry length. So I'll go ahead and cut those ends off and then cut my squash in half. And then once you have your two squash halves, what I'm going to do here is make some planks, essentially. So I'm going to cut down here lengthwise into about a half an inch to an inch thick planks. And then I'll go ahead and cut those again. So I'll take my plank here and again, cut it lengthwise. So I have about a half an inch to an inch thick French fries or my sticks. So I'll go ahead and do that. And I'll show you all what it looks like after I cut all my little French fries. Now, just a note, I will be, or I should say, Maura kindly will be emailing all the participants, so all of you joining at home, the recipes that I'm mentioning tonight. So I won't, since I am making smaller quantities for demonstration purposes, I won't be calling out the exact amounts of the recipe ingredients that I'm using. But if you do want to check out the recipes because you'd love to make them on your own later, Maura will be sending out an email with the recipes that I mentioned. So definitely feel free to check those out so you can get the full details if you want to make these recipes at home. All right, so I've cut up some of my butternut squash fry pieces here. As you can see, I have my nice fry sticks. And so what you would want to do at this point is drizzle on some oil and your favorite herbs and spices, and then toss that so it's well coated, and then pop that on a lined baking sheet and pop in the oven at 425, I would say, for about 30 to 35 minutes, and let these roast up, and then you will have your delicious French fries. Now, for sake of time tonight, I did want to make some of these fries ahead of time and show you what they look like when they're done. So I'll move my some of my supplies over to the side and I'll come a little bit closer and show you what the fries look like when they're done. So here we have a batch of the butternut squash fries I made earlier at home. And then as you can see, I waited for them to get that nice browning on the outside so they have a little bit of that crispness to them. But because it's butternut squash, it does also have that sweet and nutty undertone. So really a super delicious flavor here and they make for good French fries. So here we have our finished recipe product, but there is actually a second step to this recipe that I did want to highlight tonight, and that's to make a tasty dip for the fries. I'll call this out again for anyone with kids at home, thinking about ways to get, maybe picky eaters to try some new things, dips might be another great tactic. Because for some reason, kids love dipping foods into other foods. So having a dip and adding that different element of a taste or texture that comes with the dip can be another really great way to hopefully encourage them to take a few bites out of a new food. So the dip I'll be making today is a homemade better for you ranch dressing, because I know ranch dressing is a very popular dip. And so I figured, let's see if we can showcase how to make it a little bit more of a healthier option. So what I'll be doing to make this dip, and it's only two simple ingredients here. First off, let's talk about the base. So I have a plain non-fat Greek yogurt. And now I'm using this as the base for the dip, because when we think of other sorts of creamy based dips, they're oftentimes made with a cream product, like a sour cream, for example, which can be quite high in saturated fat, which is one of those less nutritious types of fats we want to try and limit in our diets where we can. Now, with the plain non-fat Greek yogurt, we're going to get less saturated fat than a sour cream, so we're getting that added nutrition benefit, but it's going to really give you that same taste and texture you're looking for. Because a Greek yogurt is so thick, it's going to have that creaminess like a sour cream, and if you're choosing a plain yogurt, it's going to have that same tangy taste that something like a sour cream would have. So this is going to be our more nutritious base swap for the dip. And then what we're gonna do is mix in this ranch packet. Now I actually picked up, it's a McCormick product that's called Just Five Ranch Dressing, just five, referencing the five simple ingredients that it has. And so the ingredients on this, there's actually no artificial flavor, which sometimes can be found in some ranch dressings or like ranch dressing packets, but that isn't here in this product. So if artificial flavors are something you avoid at home and you like ranch dressing, maybe this could be something fun to mix in every once in a while for a snack. So to make the dip, it's pretty simple. You can just follow the instructions on the back of your package there. So this recommends using 2 cups of the yogurt for the package. So I'll go ahead and whisk up this quick dip here. So I'll add in the yogurt. All right, and we'll move this off to the side, and then we'll add in our packet here of ranch dressing. All right, and then all I'll do, put that off to the side, and I'll just stir that up here. And then once you have the powdery, the dry mixture mixed in with your yogurt and everything is well combined, then you have your a bit better for you homemade ranch dip. And so that would pair beautifully with our fries right here. So this is our first recipe of the night. So hopefully more of a fun, unique spin on butternut squash and a different way you could experiment with it in the kitchen. So I'll put these aside for now. All right, we're gonna move into talking about our next squash option. All right, so next we are going to be talking all about spaghetti squash. Another pretty popular option in when it comes to squash. And spaghetti squash here, in terms of what to look for at the store and how to store it. Same tips for the butternut squash. So looking for those options without any cuts or cracks in it. Looking for one that has a good weight to it as well would be what to look for. And then you could store it in a cool, dry place or your countertop at home. Now, when it comes to nutrition, spaghetti squash actually contains some B vitamins. Now, B vitamins, we don't often hear too much about. I feel like they don't get too much spotlight. Vitamin C, especially this time of year, is something that we're always hearing about. But B vitamins definitely are important for our health as well. In particular, B vitamins actually help us, or like help our bodies, turn the food that we eat into energy for ourselves. So they definitely play some important roles there. So we love spaghetti squash for that reason. And it is aptly named. So it's called spaghetti squash because the inside of the squash here actually has spaghetti-like strands. And if you've ever cooked with it before, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And so some folks will use the spaghetti squash strands in place of pasta, or they'll add it to pasta dishes, since it is, like I said, kind of like spaghetti. But since that is a more common way that the spaghetti squash is used, I figured we could switch things up a little bit tonight, and I'm actually going to showcase a Tex-Mex stuffed spaghetti squash recipe. A little bit of a mouthful, but that's what we're going to be highlighting tonight. So let's go ahead and walk through the steps for making that recipe. So the first thing we'll want to do, I'll move some of my utensil I don't need out of the way. What we're going to do is we're going to cut up our spaghetti squash. Now, something I should mention is that spaghetti squash, and if you ever pick one up before, you probably feel me here, is that they can be a little bit difficult to cut. So since they have this hard exterior, and typically they have that dense flesh on the inside, it can be quite difficult to cut through it. And we want to make sure that at the end of our cooking demonstration, or at the end of when you're cooking dinner at home, you have all of your 10 fingers on with you. So you want to be really careful using a knife, especially when you're cutting up some spaghetti squash options, or really any squash, I guess I should note. And so a tip that I have is if you have found it difficult in the past to cut through a winter squash, is to microwave it a bit ahead of time. Now, what you'd want to do first is make sure you poke some pretty deep holes with a fork, or if you need to use the end of a sharp knife, you want to make sure you get quite a few puncture holes in here. And that's because you need to let a little bit of that steam release when it's microwaving, or else you might have a little bit of an explosion in your microwave. So you want to make sure we can let some of the steam release and put it in the microwave just for maybe a couple moments. That can help soften that exterior, just to make it a little bit easier to get that knife through. So just a little tip there to make it easier to cut through. What I'm going to do is I did microwave this for a little bit ahead of time, so it's going to make it hopefully a little easier to cut through on camera for you all. So I'll go ahead and for the spaghetti squash, I'm going to cut it down the center lengthwise. So I'll go ahead and give that a cut here. All right. So we have our spaghetti squash cut open. And then with other squash, as we saw with the butternut squash, we're gonna have these innards and seeds on the inside. And all you need to do is take a spoon. So I'll go ahead and grab my spoon right here and just go ahead and scoop all that out. Now again, these seeds could be edible. You could roast them up and enjoy them like pumpkin seeds. But for today, I will just be taking them out so we can put the other parts of the squash to use. All right, so I'll scoop out this half. I'll go ahead and scoop out the other half here. All right, so almost getting all those pieces out. All right, and so once you've got the those innards and the seeds out, you're left with your spaghetti squash. And what you'd want to do now at this step is to brush the insides here with some oil. You can crack a little bit of fresh pepper on top of that. And we're going to pop this in the oven. Let's see, my notes here say about 400 degrees for 35 to 45 minutes. So you might want to keep an eye on it for a little bit. What you want to happen is it to start to get that browning a little bit around the outsides. And we want to make sure that the squash, those spaghetti strands become tender. So those recommendations you'll see in the recipe as well if you do want to make this at home. But we'd want to pop this into the oven at that point on a baking sheet, cut side down. So you'd want to put them in like this. And that just helps the portion of the spaghetti squash that's touching that baking sheet to really get that nice browning to it. So put them cut side down in the oven. Now, for sake of time, again, I did a little bit of magic ahead of time, and I do have a spaghetti squash that's been roasted ready to go. So let me grab that so we can continue on with our cooking demo. So I'll move this out of the way. All right, and so here, I have my roasted spaghetti squash. So I'll bring it a little bit closer in case you want to all take a look. You'll see how I got that nice browning and a little caramelization around the outside of the strands. And so what we want to do at this point is get those spaghetti strands out of the squash. And so to do that, all you need is a fork. And I'm going to grab a bowl because what we're going to do at this point, since we're making a stuffed spaghetti squash recipe, is we're going to take the inside of the spaghetti squash, so all the strands out, put it in a bowl, add in all of our other favorite mix-ins, And then we're going to put that mixture, mix it all up so it's well combined, pop that back into the spaghetti squash and put into the oven. So we're at that step where we're making that mixture here. So all you want to do to get these strands out, like I said, grab your fork and then just move down in a downward motion. And you'll start to see, not sure if hopefully you can all see from that angle, how a lot of these strands start to come out and they're actually starting to stick to my spoon. If I come a little bit closer, hopefully you can see a little bit more in detail how all of these strands kind of look a little bit like spaghetti. Hopefully that's coming through here. You can see as I start to pick some up how that's really coming through. So I'll go ahead and I'll just keep on scraping away until I get all of that, all of those strands or all of that meat, for lack of a better word, get all that out of there. So just go ahead and scrape that down. And then you should just be left with, once you get all of those strands out, essentially just a little hollow shell, which is going to serve as, the dish or the bowl for our recipe. So I'll put my shell back over here because we're going to need that in a few moments. And now we're going to add in all the rest of our filling. Now, the recipe as written, which you'll see if you check out the recipe link after, is vegetarian. So it does have beans and rice as the filling. Now, if you did want to bump up the protein a little bit more at this step, when we're mixing in all of the other add-ins we want, you could easily add in a ground chicken or a ground turkey. That certainly would work well here. I would suggest sauteing that in a saute pan until it's fully cooked and then throw it into the bowl at this step. And then we'll add in all of the rest of the add-ins that are in the recipe. So this recipe in particular calls for some pinto beans, some canned pinto beans I'll add in here. Now, pinto beans are going to be adding in some plant-based protein. We're going to get some fiber. We're going to get some iron as well. So a really great nutrient-rich add-in. And my quick tip here when it comes to canned goods, whether it's canned vegetables or canned beans, is to try to look for low sodium or no salt added options, just to help cut back on some of that sodium content there. But a bit of a fun fact is that by draining and rinsing canned beans, so pouring this into a colander or a strainer and then running some cold water over it in the sink, does actually help remove quite a decent amount of the sodium content. So that could be another way to help cut back on some of that sodium content and make the dish a little bit more of a nutritious option. So that's my little call out for canned goods. The next thing we're going to add in is some brown rice. So that will add even more fiber to our dish here. And my favorite time-saving option for whole grains is to pick up microwavable pouches. So the our Nature's Promise line, we have a brown rice, we have a white quinoa and a red quinoa, and they heat up in under 2 minutes in the microwave. So it makes it really easy to get dinner on the table a little bit more quickly, especially during busy weeknights. So this is my favorite time-saving solution. So I popped that in the microwave earlier. So we have that ready to go. Next, we're going to add in some spinach because anywhere we can, adding in colorful vegetables is just another great way to help us meet our veggie intake and get some more nutrients into our diet. And a bit of a fun fact here is that, or maybe not so fun, about 90% of Americans don't meet their recommended intakes for vegetables, according to the most recent dietary guidelines. So really any fun or creative ways that you can think to add more veggies into the dishes you're making is just another really great way to help build that balanced eating pattern. So spinach is what we're using today, but I think if you had, or if you wanted to saute peppers and onions or zucchini or mushrooms, those would all be really delicious add-ins. So definitely get creative, or maybe use this recipe as a clean out the fridge type of dish. So at the end of the week, if you have any miscellaneous ingredients in your produce drawer, chop them up and throw them in and they would taste just delicious. So that's what we have thus far for the mix-ins. There are a few more things I want to add in here. One being some cheddar cheese. So I'll mix a little bit of that in here, just helping to add a nice creaminess, a little bit of fat to the dish. And then lastly, I'm just going to add in some seasonings. So here I am adding in some chili powder. So this adds a really nice flavor to the dish. So I'll go ahead and add a dash of that in there. and then a little bit of some pepper as well. So I'll mix that in. And then we can go ahead, I'm gonna take my spoon again and just mix that all up to make sure you know, that everything is evenly combined and we have a nice mixture going on. So we'll go ahead and give this a nice mix and then pop that back into my empty spaghetti squash shell. I'll go ahead and just refill up my squash now with my delicious and filling mixture. All right, it might be hard to stuff all that back in there, but I promise it will fit. So go ahead and just stuff that back up to the brim. All right, and so now what you'd wanna do at this point, we have our spaghetti squash filled back up. If you want, you can sprinkle some additional cheese on top. And then what you wanna do is pop this back into the oven. And that's gonna allow the mixture that's inside just to heat back up again together and be nice and warm. And then also allows that cheese to melt on the top as well. So at this point, I would pop that back into my oven to roast for just a few more minutes. But again, with my prep work ahead of time, I did wanna show you all what a finished dish would look like. So let me go ahead and grab that. And I'll come a little bit closer here to the camera. So here, we have our stuffed spaghetti squash. So as you can see, I put that cheese on the top and it melted and we have the delicious combination. We see that colorful spinach coming through. We have our beans in there, our rice, our spaghetti squash strands. So it really comes out to be a delicious and hearty and nutritious meal and a fun way to put spaghetti squash to use. Right, and so that brings us to the end of our cooking demonstration for tonight. So let me pull back out all of our finished recipes. So remember, we started with that fun way to put butternut squash to use. We made those squash fries. We made a little bit of a healthier dip. So we have our Better For You ranch here. And then we have the delicious stuffed spaghetti squash recipe. So now I'd be happy to open it up to questions if anyone does have any questions about the recipe or just generally some of the nutrition tips that I talked about tonight. Happy to open it up to that Q&A now.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Emily. yes, we do have one question in here so far. Mm-hmm. Can you share ideas on how to cook acorn squash?
Ooh, an acorn squash. Yeah, that's a really great one. So acorn squash, and for those of you not familiar, I actually do have an acorn squash on my countertop. Let me grab that just to kind of showcase for those of you not familiar what it looks like. You can point it out at the store. So this is actually, this is almost it's not exactly an acorn squash. It's technically a sweet dumpling squash. So it's a type of it, but this would essentially be kind of what an acorn squash looks like at the store. Generally, it's going to be more of this dark green color all around, but as you can see, it kind of looks like an acorn, hence the name acorn squash. So some recipes for acorn squash, let's see. Typically, something we'll often see with acorn squash recipes is similar to this spaghetti squash recipe. So it's like a stuffed acorn squash. So cutting it in half, taking out those innards and the seeds that are in the middle, and then stuffing it with you know, whatever creative direction you go in. I can send over more if you wouldn't mind sending out some additional recipes. I can do some more digging around for some acorn squash recipes. If there are some specific ones you want to try out, I can find some Better For You options and send those over as well.
Great. The spaghetti squash dish looks like it might be a bit dry. Is there some sauce you could serve with it?
That's a great question. Yeah, so I guess thinking about the inside, we didn't necessarily add in a liquid of any sort. In terms of a dip you would serve with it, I think at the end where some of your toppings, if you wanted to get creative with that, that could be where maybe some of that moisture comes in. So for example, I'm thinking with this particular dish, since it was Tex-Mex inspired, you could add like a salsa on top or even mix that in if you wanted when you were making that, filling mixture. I think adding in some salsa could add in a little bit of that liquid or a little bit of that moisture. Guacamole could be actually another really great idea to throw on the top of this. And that would add in some heart healthy fats as well. So I'd say guacamole and salsa maybe would be my two go-to options to add a little bit more moisture and some nutrition to the spaghetti squash. Great question.
Can you add nuts to stuffing? If so, which nut?
Just to clarify, nuts to stuffing, was that the question?
Stuffing, yep.
Great question. Yes, thinking especially with maybe some fall or holiday gatherings coming up, stuffing is a big go-to, a big hit on the table. I don't see why nuts couldn't be added to the stuffing. Thinking nutritionally, nuts are going to add in some fiber, you'll get a little bit of protein, you'll get some heart-healthy fats as well. So I think they can add that nice crunch to a stuffing mixture. In terms of how best to actually cook the stuffing mixture, maybe read sometimes package instructions like on a stuffing or generally on different foods might have instructions for how to add different mix-ins or toppings. So I would say if there is instructions in terms of when best to add those nuts, eating before you cook it or just sprinkle it on the top, see if they have any suggested instructions there. But I would think that could be a great way to experiment with some stuffing recipes to add a little bit more nutritional value to it.
Great. Do we have any more questions for Emily? Feel free to raise your hand as well. Any more questions? How about some ideas on how to prepare honey nut and delicata squashes as the skins are edible?
Great question. Yes. So with delicata squash, thinking I'll tackle that one first. The skin does tend to be more more delicate than say something like the butternut squash. So most recipes will actually recommend keeping that skin on when you roast them. Something I did the other night, a way that I prepared the delicata squash that I had on hand was just a simple roasting dish. So again, cutting that open, taking out those innards and seeds, chopping it up and roasting it with your favorite herbs and spices and oils until the squash gets a little bit of browning or crisping on the outside could be a great way to put the delicata squash to use. With a honey nut squash, so for those of you not familiar, I don't have one around my kitchen to show you all, but that essentially kind of looks like a butternut squash, but smaller. So it's like a condensed butternut squash and generally has more of a, I don't want to say it's dark in color because that's not necessarily the right description, but maybe not as light a beige as the butternut squash. So it's like a mini butternut squash. And I would say for that, the uses come to mind, like what you would do with a butternut squash. So could be good to peel the outside, or you could keep the outside on if that's something that you wanted, chop that up and roast it in the oven. And then even adding those roasted honey nut squash pieces to different dishes that you're making. So it certainly could be, you know, a great side dish, but I'm thinking of some really great fall or winter salads. So adding that warm or hearty component could be adding in some of those roasted honey nut squash and bits on top of the salad. That could be another, different way to put those to use. So hopefully that helped give some different ideas there.
Great. Do you prefer one type of oil?
That's a really great question. I would say when it comes to oils, nutritionally speaking, the real recommendation that I would have is just to look for an option that's going to be more heart healthy. And so what I mean by that is when you take a look at the different types of fats that are in that oil, we want to try and choose options that are higher in those unsaturated fats and looking for options that are lower in saturated fats. I may have mentioned during the cook along, but those saturated fats are the ones that we want to try and limit where we can. It would be promoting the health of our heart to try to avoid or limit those saturated fats when possible. So those heart healthy unsaturated fat oils would be really all of our non-tropical vegetable oils. And so that non-tropical component just refers to our vegetable oils that are not coconut or palm oil. And that's because coconut and palm oil do tend to be quite high in saturated fat, which is why there's that little caveat there. But whatever you have at home, if it's an olive oil, an avocado, a canola, another type of vegetable oil, nutritionally speaking, they're higher in those unsaturated fats. So they could be fine options to go for.
Great. How long can the winter squash stay fresh on the countertop?
Ooh, that's a really great question. And quite a long time. I'll say I don't have an exact number of days or weeks off the top of my head, but we find when it comes to the vegetables, winter squash do tend to be one of the options that tend to last since they are so hardy. I would say they do tend to last quite long on your countertop. I am hesitant to put an exact amount since I'm not quite sure, but you may have even known from personal experience if you have a squash lying around maybe for a week or 2 weeks because you haven't gotten around to using it. As long as it still has that firmness to it and you don't see it or don't feel any soft spots or any other signs that maybe it's past its time, I would say it'd be safe to consume. So luckily they last a little bit longer than some other veggies.
All right. Any other questions for Emily? And like I said, this is being recorded, so I'll be able to send it around to everyone tomorrow afternoon. And I also did email everyone the recipes so you can have those as well. So it looks like that's it. Thank you so much, Emily, for coming out tonight. And thank you everyone else for joining us. And hope everyone has a great night.
Wonderful. Yeah, thank you, Maura, again so much for inviting me. It was a pleasure and really great questions from all of you. So thanks so much for being engaged and for joining in. And yeah, enjoy the rest of your evening.
Great. Good night.